regular visitor, Dave Hale from the Shelley Horticulture Society. We normally catch up with Dave once every couple of months or so. Lots of useful gardening advice, things you can be getting on with in the allotment over the next couple of months and weeks to come in the garden as well. Now, Dave, I've been noticing certainly in our garden and around generally that a lot of plants like daffodils have started to come up and certain plants are perhaps coming out a little bit earlier than normal. Is there anything that we can do to kind of protect them, or is it an issue at all?
It's as we've been discussing while the record's been playing there, actually, it's been a very, very strange year. Everybody has said this, you know, there's nothing exceptional in actually saying that. It is a weird, weird year.
The leaves are still on the trees in a lot of cases.
As we were talking, you're going up Detling Hill, for instance. It's been almost like an American fall. You're looking at the coloured leaves, in fact. Yeah. Absolutely delightful. We tend not to see it too often, simply because we don't get that autumn weather that the eastern seaboard of the United States actually gets. But you were talking about daffodils and narcissi generally. That they're generally very hardy plants, and they should be fully capable of looking after themselves throughout the winter period. But they shouldn't need, as I say, too much looking after over the winter. If you feel the need to look out for your plants, and there aren't too many to look out for, don't forget people grow a lot of daffodils generally in their grass or in their flower beds or in their beds, because they look better in masses of them. If you need to look out for them, a bit of horticultural fleece, or even better, leaf mulch.
Right.
Save your leaves. We're talking about leaves. How appropriate that happens to be. Save your leaves. Don't burn them. Save your leaves and use them as a mulch if you feel the need, or there are some plants there which will need just that little bit of protection, because if it's leaf mold or leaf mulch, they will grow up through it anyway. Cold ice, snow shouldn't affect them in the ground. But if you're growing some in pots, and a lot of people do grow them in pots, and I do, raise the pot slightly off the ground to allow the air to circulate freely around and underneath the pot. So, in effect, you might feel the need to actually protect the plot rather than protect the pot. Excuse me, apologise for that. Plots on the mind, actually. To protect the pot, it's difficult to say that, rather than the flower, the plant, which will look after itself. As we all know, water ice expands, and nobody wants to repair or replace an expensive pot. None of us do, because that's the more expensive thing. With plants growing in it, especially not during the winter. The leaves, by the way, that they will disappear. Everybody says every year, where do the leaves go to? You've provided a mulch to protect some of your plants, if you wanted to.
Yep.
But mostly they'll be taken into the soil by worms. Worms do an incredible amount of taking these leaves into the soil. I've actually seen this, quite by accident, where there's a hole suddenly appears.
Yep.
And a leaf has disappeared on its end into the ground because a worm is actually taking it down. So that has a twofold purpose. It's feeding the worm. And for what other reason, nobody really knows why they do it. But it will also help to aerate and break up your soil. So rather than burning your leaves, which is anti-ecological, let's say, put them as a mulch onto your beds, leave them as a leaf mulch. Perfect.
Dave, if you are planning to go out in the garden at the weekend or over the next week or so, what sort of things can you be getting on with?
First thing I'm going to say is weather permitting.
Well,
of course, it's got cold all of a sudden, hasn't it? Yeah. But this is the time, I think, when you can go out into the garden and just stand and look and take stock generally to see what your garden has done over the year and the shape of the garden and the shape that you would like actually the garden to take perhaps in the next year or ensuing years. It's also very much a time for repair and mend, not just fences but other things which are going on in the garden as well. Clearing away rubbish that may have escaped your notice, or you have surreptitiously hidden behind plants over the summer thinking, I'll get rid of that sometime in winter, when now, of course, it becomes very visible. So the stuff that's been hidden away. If you've got a greenhouse, cleaning it up. I was actually cleaning up my greenhouse yesterday. I have a grapevine in my greenhouse, and because it's dropped all its leaves and the leaves are absolutely everywhere, it took me hours to clean it up. That was my fault, because I should have done it much earlier. But so it's cleaning up, wiping down the glass, repairing broken panels, or the glass panels on the greenhouse. It's also a time for disinfecting the greenhouse as well, and the pots, and getting them ready for next year's use, because you're going to need pots. If you leave it, then you find, of course, that you've got three or four jobs to do very quickly while your plants or your seedlings are growing up, and you think, I've got to get those into pots or grow them on. It's still time for pruning established bushes and trees as well, because you can see the shape of them now, while they're dormant, obviously. Get rid of any broken, diseased branches, as well as the spindly stems, or those that kind of cross or are growing inwards, because what you're ideally looking for is to allow more light into the centre of a plant and allow the air to circulate freely within the plant or through the plant. And that'll also help to cut down disease. And that's particularly true of fruit trees, of course, where you get this kind of crossing and rubbing of branches.
Yeah.
Inevitably, something's got to give, and it's usually the bark, and that allows disease or bacterium or whatever it happens to be, viruses, to get in. Hence, you're going to have to start chopping back the tree. If you've got either growing in your garden, as I said to you just now, I do actually have, you prune the grapevine back to one bud from the main stem. Again, you will be able to see what the shape of the plant is likely to look like
next season.
Climbing roses, cut them back to a suitable length. I used to have a fair warning, a climbing or rambling rose in my garden. I tugged the one end and about the trees moved about 20 feet away from it. It had literally grown through everything else and I had no idea that's where it was. And I suppose you could say it was a laziness on my part. I should have looked out for it. So cutting back to a suitable length. Leave the winter flowering climbers, such as jasmine, until after they've flowered. You'll want those to flower throughout the winter period and the very early spring. And although it's not strictly gardening, it's more DIY. There's always DIY in a garden, isn't there? While you've got the ladder out, check your gutters, because that's when you find out where all the unswept leaves have gone. It's always the same. How did that lot of mulch get in there? Again, you can use the leaves as your mulch, in effect. One other thing as well is lots of us now have garden furniture, which is very expensive. And cover, protect your garden furniture. Put it under an awning, put it under plastic, if you can't actually bring it inside or put it inside. And I suppose the last thing is, if you're having a bonfire, and I make this plea, as all gardeners make that particular plea, if you're having a bonfire, make sure there's no hibernating animals in the pile. I'm thinking of friendly animals like frogs, toads, slowworms and hedgehogs, although even rats and mice you wouldn't want to burn, if you know what I mean. It's much better to make, as we said previously, it's much better to make leaf mould from the fallen leaves for a spring mulch rather than just burning them and running the risk of killing friendly animals. So yeah, lots still to be doing over the next week or so, and possibly into the next couple of months, which is of course what we're going to go on to talk about in a minute.
Dave, looking a little bit further ahead, what can you be getting on with in the garden over the next months to come, and are there any sort of useful gardening tips along with that?
Yeah, I think it's obviously a quieter time for the plot of the garden. It's time for reflection, but there's still plans that you can make for the following seasons. You might want to plan some changes, look closely at what's not perhaps been so successful, or you might want to look out for new varieties. There's absolutely no reason why you shouldn't scour the catalogues or go around, the garden centres or the plant places, looking for new varieties that could be attractive or will basically complement what you might already have. Something else that will go along, another colourway, for instance, another shape of a plant, to compare with the existing ones you may or may not have in your garden. There's always a patch that you forgot to dig. We've just been discussing that, haven't we? We've forgotten to do it. Although you're much more timely than I am. Apparently you've been good guys. You've been doing it it's needed basis.
The warmer weather, it gives us longer to sort of get the garden sorted out this year.
It's been it might not happen again next year. That's
the
problem.
No, I don't think it will.
So it's been exceptional this particular year. But as I say, there's always that patch you forgot to dig. So if the ground's soft enough, get it dug over. And I'm as guilty as anybody for not doing it. It might just be the final position for one of those bare-rooted trees that you've bought, that you healed in sometime previously. Getting off the soil rather, sorry, no puns intended, but look to your tools and sharpen them up if they've got blunt or worn through use. There's nothing worse than a blunt tool in a garden, because it means you need excessive force to actually do the same job. And there's always the risk or the danger of an accident actually happening. They're very dangerous places. I don't want to put anybody off, but they can be dangerous places, gardens. Check the cables for that reason. Check the cables of electrically powered tools. There's nothing like being safe and use an RCD. If you're still in this fine weather we're having, you're still cutting grass, which we were late November, I think. One last tip. It has got colder. It is getting colder. So it's as well to have the fleece, the bubble wrap, the straw, the newspaper, sacking, or any other piece of carpeting or suitable item ready that will wrap up and protect your less hardy plants from the winter weather. Again, we've been discussing throughout the evening just exactly when do I go out and cover my fuchsias up or the less hardy plants. Yeah. Well, I've got to be quick. You know, what do I do? Do I look out at midnight or 2 o'clock in the morning and the torch is shining in the garden thinking I'm wrapping it up now, dear? You know, especially when your neighbour is appearing through the bench. Yeah. He's out there again doing it. You know. So, as I say, plants cost time and money, and no one wants to see a prized specimen fall victim to bad weather, least of all gardeners, in effect. And just before we finish on this particular tip, don't forget to feed the birds. They are... and provide some fresh water as well as feed, actually, that they still need to drink throughout the winter. They'll be your friends next year, feeding themselves and their young and all those nasty little pests that seem to accumulate just when you're not looking. The birds are constantly working. And feed the animals, feed the birds, feed those friendly animals that you need. They're your friends.
We're talking to Dave Hale this evening here at the Monday Night Community Show. Dave from the Shebby Horticultural Society, our regular visitor.